Hi, this is Dr. Shah. I'm giving a talk on chronic urticaria entitled The 7-Week Itch. In this talk, we will give a brief overview of chronic urticaria or hives. In particular, we will cover some of the clinical features of chronic urticaria and touch on some of what's known about the pathophysiology of this disorder. Finally, we will talk about therapeutics that are out there and how we use them to help our patients. Here's a basic outline of the talk. We'll start with a patient presentation and then go through the various topics listed here. But let's start with the case. A 59-year-old female presents to your primary care clinic complaining of a rash and itching for the last 7 weeks. She describes the rash as very itchy, red, raised circular welts. Individual spots will last about 5 to 6 hours, but when they disappear, new ones appear in their place. She cannot identify any triggers such as food, medications, or activities. She states these symptoms have significantly affected her quality of life and that she cannot sleep due to the pruritus. Based on these symptoms, you consider that she may have chronic urticaria. So what is chronic urticaria, which is sometimes also referred to as chronic idiopathic urticaria, and how is it different from acute urticaria? Quite simply, it is the presence of urticarial lesions, also known as hives, for greater than 6 weeks. The delineation between greater or less than 6 weeks is somewhat arbitrary. However, the majority of acute urticaria will resolve by 6 weeks. How common is urticaria? It's very common. Some reports state that up to 20% of the population develop urticaria at some point in their life. However, only about 1% of the population has chronic urticaria. There does not seem to be a race or nationality predilection. However, it is more common in adults than in children, and like many immune-mediated diseases, is twice as common in women as it is in men. The lesions themselves appear to be erythematous, raised, well-circumscribed plaques or wheals. A hallmark of the disease is that the lesions are intensely pruritic. Hives generally last for a few to several hours, but rarely last longer than a day. If lesions last more than 24 hours, one should consider an alternative diagnosis, such as urticarial vasculitis. Another feature often seen in patients with chronic urticaria is dermatographism. Dermatographism, as depicted in the picture here, is a phenomenon where one can simply scratch the skin, for example, with the edge of a tongue depressor, and within seconds, a hive will develop in the scratched skin. One can even write words in hives, as shown. When considering a diagnosis of urticaria, which unto itself does not describe the underlying pathology, it is helpful to consider potential etiologies. I like to think about etiologies in four different but related groups. First, some patients may have an autoimmune etiology, where a specific antibody can be detected on blood work. In addition, a type of autoimmune vasculitis can present with urticaria, as can thyroid disease, which often has an autoimmune etiology. Second, physical urticaria occurs in the presence of a physical trigger, such as pressure, cold exposure, sun exposure, water exposure, or repeated vibration. Patients often do not make the causative connection themselves, so a careful history is necessary. For example, in pressure-induced urticaria, lesions will often occur in areas such as an underwear line where clothing is tight on the skin. Third, food and drugs can cause urticaria, and while these triggers are often identified by the patient, they may be missed. Some medications do not cause a specific allergy, but can directly stimulate mast cells to release mediators leading to hives. Opiates are an example. Fourth and finally, a number of viral and parasitic infections can lead to hive formation. Of note, these specific etiologies only describe about 40 to 50% of chronic urticaria. All others fall into the group of chronic idiopathic urticaria. The main cellular mediator of urticaria is the mast cell, which upon stimulation releases histamine and prostaglandins. These factors lead to the wheal formation, vasodilation, and erythema that make up the hive. The activation of the complement system also leads to production of C5a, which is considered an anaphylotaxin and attracts the neutrophils and eosinophils, which are generally noted on biopsy specimens. Autoimmune antibodies can be found in some patients and typically are either an antibody to the IgE receptor on mast cells or anti-thyroglobulin or antimicrosomal antibodies in thyroid disease. The direct pathogenic role of these autoantibodies, however, is unknown. How does one make the diagnosis of chronic urticaria? Well, as mentioned, it involves a detailed history, and sometimes a patient has to keep a good diary of food, medications, and activities to look for potential triggers. This is particularly important for physical urticaria. A test for dermatographism, which is easily done in the office, is often performed and can be helpful. In terms of lab tests, we will often check a CBC, as well as inflammatory markers and complement levels. Complement will often be low in cases of urticarial vasculitis. As mentioned in the previous slide, looking for autoimmune antibodies can also be helpful. If a lesion is biopsied, it will often demonstrate dermal edema, blood vessel dilation, and mild perivascular infiltrate, predominantly consisting of monocytes and CD4-positive lymphocytes. Some forms exist in which neutrophils and/or eosinophils predominate. Skin or blood testing for food allergies without a clear clinical history is not useful, and there are relatively high rates of false negatives and positives. Let's talk about treatment. The mainstay of treatment for chronic urticaria are antihistamines. Typically, non-sedating antihistamines such as fexofenadine or cetirizine are used. However, a dosage is 2 to 4 times used for treatment of seasonal allergies. Sedating antihistamines such as hydroxyzine are often used at night or for breakthrough symptoms during the day. If symptoms are refractory to antihistamines, there are a number of agents that modulate the immune system that have been used, although there is not a great deal of evidence from randomized controlled trials to support their use. These agents include cyclosporin, hydroxychloroquine, dapsone, danazol, and methotrexate. Finally, prednisone can be used for acute flares. However, symptoms typically return after tapering down the dose, and due to side effects, prednisone is not a good long-term option. The prognosis of chronic urticaria is quite good. About 35 to 50% improve in 1 year, although of the subtypes, the physical urticarias are the most refractory to treatment. Symptoms tend to be less severe and resolve in patients under 30 years old. Fortunately for most patients, in many cases, eventually symptoms do resolve spontaneously. In summary, chronic urticaria is a common condition defined as the presence of urticarial lesions or hives for greater than 6 weeks. Patients will often complain that the lesions are intensely pruritic and generally last a few hours and almost always less than 24 hours. There are a number of etiologies for hives, including autoimmune and physical causes, although many cases are idiopathic. A careful history is crucial for determining potential triggers, although lab work can be helpful. Antihistamines are the mainstay of treatment, although immunosuppressants may be needed. Prognosis is fortunately quite good. And here are some key references that you can look up to learn more about chronic idiopathic urticaria.